need a good meeting on a Friday or a Monday night over Calvary Chapel in Northeast Philly, Philmont Avenue, it's a great place to go. And without any further ado, a real man of God, here's Timmy Patrick.
Yeah.
Of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Therefore, verse 29, since we are his offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in the righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, while others said, we will hear again on this matter. So Paul departed from them. However, some men joined him and believed, among them Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for everyone here tonight, Lord God. We just want to step out the way. Lord, we want you to step in front of us, Lord. Let us hear from you. Not what we have to say or anybody else has to say, but you. And you get all the glory. It's in your great name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So the book of Acts. Some type of the Bible, it says the Acts of the Apostles. The book of Acts summarizes the growth of the church in the first century. Jesus had returned to heaven. And he sent his Holy Spirit. Well, why did he send his Holy Spirit? To indwell, to guide, and to empower his disciples. Empowers his disciples to do what? As they were scattered all over the world, preaching the word, the gospel, and the saving grace of the Lord. Jesus himself, before he blew out of there, he says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Paul, who was Saul, got knocked off his horse, and now this is where he's wrong. This is during Paul's second missionary journey, and he steps in front of these wise guys in Athens, Greece. He's walking around Greece, and he's noticing that all these idols and objects of worship. And he says to them, I even found an altar with the inscription to the unknown God. To the unknown God. Now it makes you wonder if these people are worried about if they left a God out. God forbid we leave one out. We don't want to get whatever God it is upset with us. So let us dedicate an altar to an unknown God too. So now Paul stands in front of all these cats, right in the midst of them, and he has their attention. Let me tell you, as he says, this God that you think is unknown, that's who I'm going to talk to you about today. So in verse 24, he says, God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. Right there, Paul is speaking about the greatness of God. And then he continues in verse 25, he says, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. Now here in verse 25, he's speaking of the goodness of God. Paul is saying he's our creator, he's our provider, but these men, these philosophers, these aristocrats, they were so full of themselves, they're worshiping creation, and they're glorifying themselves. They're like the Mutual Admiration Society. And they ain't got nothing to do but stand around and talk about intellectual things. So these verses that we're studying here today, verses 26 through 29, Paul's talking about the government of God. And we're going to finish in verses 30 to 34. He's then talking about the grace of God. So we're going to talk about the greatness of God, the goodness of God, the government of God, and the grace of God. With these verses right here, all that horizontal stuff that they're all talking about and looking around about and all intellectual about, Paul is now going to dive into it deeper. And he's going to take it to the vertical. I want to read you a different interpretation. God created all the people of the world from one man, Adam, and scattered the nations across the face of the earth. He decided beforehand which should rise and fall and when. He also determined their boundaries. His purpose in all of this is that they should seek after God and perhaps feel their way toward Him and find Him, though He is not far from any of us, for in Him we live and move and are. Now this is really deep for these cats. They're like, wait a minute. Because they actually felt like they were a special race. They felt like they were different from all the other nations. And what Paul was doing right there, he's affirming otherwise. Paul tells them, he says, every human being, every diversity, every nation came from the same blood. And he decides the time and place each one of our births. So if you're born in a nut house, like I was, break that cycle. Break that cycle straight up. Very interesting. Verse 27. There's an interesting word there. The word is grope. Some interpretations, like the one I just read, say feel. Is the worship team still here? Them girls still here? Where are they at? Girls, let me tell you something. Straight up, that word grope blows me away. If you study that word grope in the Greek, it's actually a form of worship. The original meaning of that word is two strange words, to twitch or to twang, for real. In other words, to play a stringed instrument and celebrate the divine worship of God with music. So praise the Lord for the worship team.
Yeah.
My problem was I had misplaced worship. I groped for a bag of dope. I searched for a bag of dope. That was my worship. I had misplaced worship. That was my idol, a bag of dope. Some of them Bibles say feel. That word feel, the same thing as to search for. I worshiped a drink or a drug. Misplaced worship. How many of us in this room had that same type of worship? Look what he says. At the beginning of that verse, he says that they should seek the Lord. And then at the end of that verse, look what he says. He is not far from any one of us. Paul just hit these wise guys with a lot of stuff here. And I'm wondering if they're thinking, you know what, man? You know, they get together, they're all about this. Man, you hear what he said? You know, he said, I don't know what he said. Wait a minute, Paul. This is a little frightening, brother. This guy you're speaking about sounds like he's the grand poopa of all gods. As a matter of fact, it's a little scary. He's probably even too awesome for us to get near to. Paul says, you know what? I got news for you. He is all that and a bag of chips. But he's available all the time. He's available all the time. My first 18 months, I would tell people I'm a heroin addict Christian. I love the Lord, but every so often I got to go do some dope. When I was trying to figure out this relationship, this thing with God, it was like a roller coaster for me. But you know what? For some reason, I believe God was there in the midst all the time. Chuck, I would do four bags of dope and read the Bible for 2 hours. And then all of a sudden I'm reading and it says, light and darkness don't mix. And I'm like, uh-oh. Straight up, there is within every man that attention, which is the word I'm looking for, that cry for a meaningful relationship with God. There is. When a person puts their heads on the pillow at night, they are conscious of that void. Let me tell you where that void, John, comes from. The smartest man in the world besides Jesus, Solomon, wrote this in the book of Ecclesiastes. He said, God has made everything appropriate in its time. He also set eternity in our hearts. What that means is we have a spiritual thirst, we have eternal value, and nothing but God can satisfy that. All the stuff that we try to fill with a drink or a drug or pornography, a cheating girlfriend, whatever it is, cheating boyfriend, whatever we try to fill with, nothing's going to fill that void but God Himself. You sit down and start thinking, all right, nothing's going to satisfy but you, Lord. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to plug in with you, Lord. But then all of a sudden, Satan shoots a fiery dart out there. All of a sudden, the flesh kicks in, and there we go, running and gunning again. But I'm here to tell you, if you're sitting here today, you've been graced. Yes. You've been graced. Look at verse 30. Verse 30 says, truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked. But now, He commands all men everywhere to repent. Whew. Graced. Three words in that verse. Truly, these times of ignorance, number one. God overlooked, but now commands, number two. All men everywhere to repent. Three strong words. Ignorance, we'll talk about it in a minute, commands, and repent. Now, I just said, you guys have been graced. I don't know where that came from. I don't know if I read it or heard it or whatever. Hopefully it's the Holy Spirit. But I love that word, graced. Every now and on Monday night, we're going to have somebody blowing air in the meeting, and I'll say, yo, how you doing? And I'll say, I'm good, man. I'll say, you sure? And then they say, yeah, we're all sinners, saved by grace. And then I say, do not cheapen grace. Do not minimize the work on the cross. Yes, we are saved by grace, but do you live a life of repentance and obedience? Yes, we are saved by grace, but do you live a life of repentance and obedience? This cat Paul, who we're reading about right here, Paul, would speak to write a letter to the church in Rome and to believers everywhere. And Paul would write this, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin so that grace may abound? And he says, certainly not. Actually, a few verses later, he says, shall we sin because we are not under law? We're under grace. He says, God forbid. God forbid. And it'd be years later, but when he wrote this verse, he was talking about the long-suffering of God. God tolerated man's past ignorance about these things. Now he commands us to turn away from our misplaced worship. Very interesting word, ignorance. You study that word in the Greek, it actually has three meanings. Number one, to know. When I was out there, I was a full-fledged drug addict or alcoholic. I didn't know anything about any relationship with God. The second meaning is not to understand. Eventually, in your addiction, you put your head on a pillow. You look up. The fan is spinning and spinning and spinning. And your heart's pounding out of your chest. And then you realize, I don't understand what's going on here, but something's not right. And then the third meaning, which is scary, that's the negative implication. To ignore. To ignore. If anybody is sitting here today, you cannot cop a plea with either one of these meetings because you just heard. Wake up early on Saturday morning. And I'm dying for a bag of dope. And I rob my kids' piggy banks. And I got $11.75 in quarters. Bam! I'm good, man. I blow out of my house. I'm driving down the way. I realize the guy who's on duty today will not take change. I got to get a $10 bill. He won't even take two fives. I stop at this gas station. I walk in there. I'm looking. I'm feeling it out. Because my man knows. Probably want to know. I need the $10 bill to get some dope. But I'm feeling it out. And all of a sudden, the cat walks in front of me and stands in front of me. Dude walks up to the counter. There's the cat standing in front of me. And I'm standing behind him. And all of a sudden, the dude behind the counter starts talking to the guy in front of me about Jesus. Oh, why you ruin my high, Lord? Dude starts talking about Jesus, and the cat's like, hey, okay, you know. And then he says to me, he says, yo, you. I'm like, yeah. He says, do you know the Lord? And I'm like, yeah. Oh, yeah. But, bro, I'm only here to get a $10 bill because I need a bag of dope. I'm not saying that to him, but that's what's going through my head. Don't be talking to Jesus stuff to me right now. I just need a bag of dope. And he says to me, well, why don't you tell my man in front of you about the Lord? For real. I'm like, yeah, brother, you know, massage your shoulders a little bit. Go, man, do what you got to do, bro. You know what I mean? I got to go. I got to go to work, you know? And the guy behind the counter says like this, well, you know what? I got something to tell you, my friend. He says to the guy in front of me. He said, the word gospel means good news. The good news is we can spend eternity in heaven with God, but here's the deal. The Bible, the Word of God, tells us we have all sinned, and we all fall short of the glory of God. And it tells us that the wages of sin is death. And I'm like, oh, come on, man, I'm starting to sweat. He says the punishment we earn for our sins is death, not just physical death, but eternal death also. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And he says to the cat, you know why? And the dude says, why? He said, because why? We were out there still sinning. Jesus died for us. Now I'm like really getting convicted. But I'm still going to go for the $10 bill. He says, in other words, Jesus Christ died for our sins. Jesus paid the death, paid the price with his death for our sins. So the Bible tells us that if we confess that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, and we trust Jesus' death for payment of our sins, then we are saved from eternal death. And I'm like, it's got to be done now. That's the whole Romans Road, John. He says, guy, what can I get for you? You guys just thank you very much. Turns around, says to me, thank you very much. I say, you know what, man? I got my honey bun, my little Debbie honey bun, $1.50. I need that sugar. I said, bro, can I get a $10? You need some change this morning? Can I get the $10 bill off you, man? He said, give me your change. And he gave me the change. He gave me the $10 bill. And I get in the car, and my belly's rolling. I'm wiping sweat. I'm happy. I'm thinking I'm going to cop a bag of dope, and no disrespect, I'm farting. You guys understand it. Everything is going. Man, I'm ready to go. My body is moving now. My body is ready for a bag of dope. I'm ready to go. And I'm being straight up with you. So I pulled over, and I started writing down what that brother said behind the counter because I knew I was going to use it again another day. Paul says, truly, them times of ignorance, Timmy, is dead. God now calls you to repent. Repentance, turn around, metanoia. Repentance, you'll see repentance. You'll notice repentance in people's lives. Now we're clean and sober, we're called to repent and to obey. He tells these cats, these wise guys, as ignorant as you were before, it is now time for you to change. Look at verse 31. Because God has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. Strong words right there. On which he will judge the world. I'm going to be straight up with you. That's grace. That's not mean words. That's opportunity. Because the author who wrote the book of Hebrews tells us this. Jesus himself was in all points tempted like we are. Jesus understands our weakness. Do you get that? Do you understand that? Paul says, is what I'm telling these know-it-alls. He said, God is going to judge the world and be righteous with his judgment. And the standard for his judgment, in the middle of that verse where it says, by the man, Jesus Christ. Jesus is the man. Amen. No pun intended. Jesus is the man. God's going to be righteous with his judgment. And the standard for that judgment is Jesus. And it's Jesus. God testifies to Jesus' righteousness by raising him from the dead. In other words, Jesus understands our battle. Sometimes we wage war on ourselves through our addiction. The collateral damage with the family members, the support people go through it too. But the book of Hebrews tells us there's a high priest who understands all of that. Who understands all of that. Verse 32 says, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, while others said, we will hear you again on this matter. So Paul departed from among them. However, some men joined him and believed, among them Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. Now look, soon as Paul mentioned that word, resurrection, that blew their minds. That freaked them out right away. There's three different responses here. One of the responses is some of them mocked and some of them laughed, and they didn't take Paul's message seriously. You see, some of them Greeks who were standing there, they were mocking because they believed the body was only a prison. And the sooner a person left the body, the happier he would be. Why raise a body from the dead to live again? Others said, we will hear you again on this matter. Woo! Procrastination is the worst, most hideous, harmful response you could ever have towards the gospel. Procrastination is the most harmful response you could ever possibly have. Oh, think about tomorrow. I bet you if you would take a Gallup poll in hell, you would find out the most common cause for somebody being there is they put off a decision to accept Jesus until it was too late. And then it says, some men join and believe. That word, however, I hate this expression, but I'm going to say it to you anyway. I heard a guy gave the definition of however. He said, people tend to put on weight in middle age. However, gaining weight is not inevitable. I'm thinking about that. I remember I'd have 60, 90 days clean and sober, and then the next thing you know, man, I want to get high. And I know my brother Michael got a few bucks in his pocket, so what do? I go in my bedroom, and I take off my extra large shirt, and I put on my medium shirt. Now, when I put on my medium shirt, it's tight against me, and it looks like I'm gaining a little weight. And I get out of the car, he goes, man, you look good, Tim. I'm like, yeah, man, I was just thinking on getting some money. I forgot my money. I said, what do you mean? Give me 20, bro. Boom. You look great. Dope fiending my brother to get money for a bag of dope because I've been getting high for a few weeks already. Put on that medium when I should have an XL and it looked like I got some meat on. Sitting in the house, man, the kids are playing, I'm sweating, I got to cop some dope. I said, well, I said, babe, I need a meeting. Well, I need a meeting. She's like, okay, go. Bam. I go down the way. I cop. I hang out for a little bit. Get a Pepsi, a Milky Way. I'm hanging with everybody down there. I'm digging the whole scene. I got to shoot home. I'm driving home. I get a block away from the house. I pull over to the curb. I find a cigarette butt. I light it. I stick it under my shirt. Because I don't smoke. Put it all around me here. Throw the cigarette down. Get in the car. I walk in the house. My wife goes, phew. I said, yeah, they all smoke in them meetings, babe. For real. Getting high is not inevitable. However, nonetheless, I love it. Nonetheless, some men join and believe. Praise the Lord. This text totally demonstrates the sovereignty of God in salvation. One person's heart is softened by the message, and another person's heart is soured by the message. The same message, the same truth, a totally different response. What I like about this verse here, this verse 34, is if Luke is the writer of the book of Acts, and if Luke's going to take the time to put these people's names in there, then I'm going to read about who they are. Because there's got to be a reason why he put their names in there. I heard one guy say, "What is the sweetest sound in the world? A person's own name." I said, "Yeah, stand in front of a judge." And he says, "Timmy Patrick." I'm like, "Yeah." Dionysius the Areopagite. The Areopagites were a group of men who people said they were special. They were intellects. They were very smart. We're lucky to have them in our world. But look what it says here. Dionysius, he believed. Because you know what he did? He traveled the toughest road to travel in life, the 18 inches from here to here. Special? Intellect? No, special because he's going to heaven. And he mentioned Damaris. If you study that, you study that whole thing, what was going on that day. Paul was actually on Mars Hill. You can see the temple for Zeus over there. It was nuts. All these big pillars and cathedrals, but all over the world. So when something like that was going on, when somebody special was speaking there, there was only like a certain crowd that was allowed there. No proper woman would be seen in that type of company. A public gathering like that. So that tells us that the Damaris was probably a prostitute. And it says Dionysius and Damaris joined in and they believed. So I'm going to finish with this. The gospel has just reached both ends of the spectrum. From one of the smartest cats in the world to where people believe one of the lowest humans in the world as a prostitute are now saved, believed, and joined together in eternity with Jesus Christ. Amen. That whole joint I read about that guy in front of me at the gas station? If you don't know who Jesus Christ is today, that guy behind that counter explained it perfectly. That if you confess with your mouth and mean it in your heart, then you will be saved from eternal death because Jesus Christ paid the price for your sins. If you have never done that today, during this last worship song, come on, stand up front. There'll be people up here to pray with you. For real. He created all the people of the world from one man, Adam, and scattered the nations across the face of the earth. He decided beforehand which should rise and fall and when. He determined their boundaries. His purpose in all this is that you should seek God. I'm going to bring it home to us, close to the chest. Though he is not far from any of us, for in him we live and move and are. And even one of your poets said, we are the sons of God. If this is true, we shouldn't think of God as an idol made by men from gold or silver or chipped from stone. God tolerated man's past ignorance about these things, but now he commands everyone to put the idols away and worship him. For he has set a day for justly judging the world by the man he appointed, and has pointed out by bringing him back to life again. When they heard Paul speak of the resurrection of a person who'd been dead, some laughed, but others said, we want to hear more about this later. That ended Paul's discussion with all of them. But a few joined him and became believers, among them Dionysius, a member of the city council, and a woman named Damaris, and others. Father God, I just thank you for your word. I thank you how you can reach out to the most smartest, to the most lowest, what this horizontal world deems. You are so much bigger than all this, Lord God. You are the true and living God Walk us through the rest of this day, Lord Jesus. And for any of us in here struggling with a drink or a drug or pornography or whatever, Lord God, step in front of us, Jesus, and you get all the glory. It's in your great name we pray, Lord. Amen. Amen.